I think I'm going to start. Okay. So, nice to see you, at least, even if only virtually, of course. This is a pity, but that's how it is. Let's hope that next time I will be able to come there. I would really love to, actually. Okay, so my lecture is going to be a pretty long one because it's going to last for 2 hours with a break. It's I decided to present a very introductory material, so nothing really, well, maybe just a few of the things that we are doing recently, but I really wanted to give you at least an idea of what you can do with dimensional reduction and clustering, and well, try to convince you of the reason why this is very, very important for well, high dimensional and heterogeneous data such as those which are very often met in material science. Okay, one thing I would really love if you would interrupt me with questions. So this for me is very, very important. I don't know if the network allows to keep the cameras on. If this is the case, just yeah, you can do it, but otherwise, please switch on your camera and your mic whenever you want, because so I think it's so this is really a lecture where I really would like to leave a take-home message to all of you, let's say. All right. Okay. So I'm Alessandro Laio. I have two affiliations. One is CISSA. I'm working in the Statistical and Biological Physics Group. And the other is ICTP, where I am a consultant of the Condensed Matter Group. Okay, so here we start from a very, very simple online exercise, well, which is spotting the difference between two different data sets. All right, so here I'm going to open open two different data sets, and you can actually tell me what is the difference between these two data sets according to you. Okay, so the first data set is this one, where I have, okay, so basically this data set is a data set from material science. It's not really relevant what it is about, but basically I have 28 features and a quantity that I want to predict, which is this last column here. And in total, I have something of the order of 30,000 lines. So 28 features, 30,000 lines, and a quantity that I want to predict. Okay, so this is one data set, and this is instead another data set so this thing is from another thing that I am doing recently, which is the prediction of the efficacy of COVID treatment. So this is done in collaboration with an hospital here. So in this data set, instead of having only 28 features, I have 1,000 features. And not only I have 1,000 features, but as you can see, some of the features, let's look at this one, for example. So this is, for example, something that tells if a given patient has a pathology or not. So then here I can have a 0 if he or she doesn't have the pathology, 1 if he has the pathology, or in many cases, I have a blank here, nothing. So here in many, many patients, these data are missing. Okay, so here then, okay, so this is another kind of thing that can happen, that some of the features are dates. So this date is the date when the patient did the exam. So then we can go ahead. Well, there are, okay, here, well, as you can see, some of the features are numbers. This, I think, is the fever. So this is the fever that the patient has at a given day. And these are blood exams of some other sort. All right? Okay, so these are, well, let's say that these two databases are two extreme, two examples of how data from real world application can look like. All right, so now, here I think that you were all be able that these two data sets look completely different. So in an artificial data set, which is the first one that I have shown you, which is it's very good for an exercise. What I have is that I have that my features are all real numbers varying on the same range. I have no missing values. Then I have something of the order of 10,000 data points and something of the order of 10 features. So here in that specific example, which I have shown, the features were actually 28, but here we are talking about orders of magnitude. Now, if I go to real world data sets, so in real world data sets, the database, that is the thing that I have shown to you just before, contains features which can be highly heterogeneous. Some features are categorical. Like I can have like three or four different categories, and then I can have categories A, B, C, D. Since some other features are text, so I can have just something that gives me a label to a different to a data point. Some features are real numbers. Other features are logical, yes or no, right? Moreover, I have in real world data sets, I have several missing entries, like the blank empty fields, which you have seen in the previous data sets. And moreover, more importantly, and this is actually a really, really important point, I typically have 1,000 data points. Well, I have much less data points than in artificial data sets, and much more features. So this is, an evident, a clear example in the data set which I have shown you, but it is something that happens to be the case even if you work on material science. So clearly, material science, if you work on material science and then you are able to generate your data set on your own by your molecular dynamics or your ab initio calculation, then let's say that you can be more in this ballpark here. But if you are start working with experimental data, then you can easily be in this ballpark here, because, for example, you can have relevant data on, let's say, something of the order of 1,000 different materials, and then you can have like very, very different, information on each material. Like, for example, the thermal conductivity, which is a real number. Then, is this a superconductor or not, which can be a logical variable. So in general, even if heterogeneity of features is something which is easier to expect in a clinical database, you can have it also in databases in material science. For sure, you have heterogeneity in the units of measures, right? You can have, like, for example, the melting temperature and the thermal conductivity. So these are, well, two real number features, but they have totally different units of measure. So how can you mix these two different features in a predictor? Moreover, another thing that is very, very common in experimental databases is the fact that you have several missing entries. Several missing entries. Maybe because, you know, on some materials you have measured everything, on other materials there are several things that you simply haven't measured. So you just have missing entries. Okay? Okay, so this actually poses what I call the big data paradox. So real world learning sets, which you can use to train your model, are typically either uniform but relatively small, or large but heterogeneous. Like, for example, going back to our material science database. So let's say that you want to study a specific class of materials which can show superconductivity. So in this case, the candidate materials which you can actually consider in your training set are relatively few, because only for few materials you know that, for example, these materials are high temperature superconductors. So your training set will necessarily be small. Now, which actually means that you will have relatively few data points on which you can train your model. On the other hand, you can accept to have data points. So if you want to have instead a large database for training your model, you are enforced to include also materials or data points which have very little to do with the thing that you want to do, and you end up with something which is large, but then it becomes heterogeneous, right? So here, typically you have to always, when you attempt to use machine learning to build a model from your data, you have to choose a balance. You have to choose a balance between having many data points, but then in this case you'll have an heterogeneous data set, maybe with several missing data, or a small but uniform data sets, or a small but uniform data set, but where basically all your data points are in a way fully pertinent with the scientific question that we want to address, but in this case, this is small. Okay, so the corollary of all this story is that in all the fields of science, including material science, data sets which happen to be at the same time uniform and large are precious as gold. So here really they have literally a monetary value, and typically are very difficult to find. So what you can find typically online are things that are illustrative databases with relatively little scientific value, or they are typically small, and also in this case it's very, very difficult to extract scientific information from these databases. Okay, needless to say that in material science, there is an enormous ongoing effort for going, well, for overcoming this problem. Here, I think, well, Matthias Scheffler, I don't know if he's in the audience, but for sure, well, he's among the organizers of this workshop. He's one of the world leaders in trying to make data for performing predictive material science available to everybody for research and development. And I think that as a community, we are doing really, really a great job in this direction. But I don't want, so I think it's very, very important to be aware that all of this is really not for free. There is a lot of work going on in trying actually to build and make available to the community large and uniform data sets. Precious as gold in this specific context means that all of this doesn't come for free. Comes at the price of a lot of dedicated work from many, many people. All right. So this was, let's say, a preliminary introduction on the reason why, on the typical nature of data sets that one uses in building models in material science and beyond. So here, let's say that the typical nature of real world data sets is the fact that they have many different features, and these features can typically be even heterogeneous. So here we can maybe go back to this point later in my lecture, but for the moment let's only consider the fact that I have many features to deal with. All right. Okay, so here, let's say that most of the approaches for unsupervised learning are rooted in what I call the manifold hypothesis. So data typically come in the form of a large matrix of feature, and one can think of a data set as a cloud of points living in a very high dimensional space defined by these features. So in material science, the most simple example of this is a molecular dynamic trajectory of a large system. So here in this case, the features are simply all the coordinates of your atoms. Okay. So if such cloud of points were to occupy the entire space uniformly, there will be absolutely no hope of extracting any kind of useful information. So imagine that you have 10,000 coordinates and then you have, let's say, 1,000 data points. So basically, each data point will be so far from any other meaningful data point that extracting a meaningful information from that, it would be totally impossible. So luckily, in most real world applications, including data science, including material science applications, the points typically lie on a manifold, which has a dimension which is much smaller than the number of features. So here I have drawn an example of such a manifold, which is, let's say, immersed in this case in a three-dimensional space, but the dimension of my data manifold is actually only two in this case. So this is actually the key which allows to perform dimensional reduction. So this is actually really like, so if the data would not really live on a manifold which a much smaller dimension, then it would be totally impossible to perform a dimensional reduction on my data sets. Okay? Okay, so here I don't know if there are questions on this preliminary part of my lecture. Please interrupt me if there are questions. Okay, so if not, I'm going to present very, very qualitatively, due to the fact that it's a relatively short lecture. One of the first thing that one might be willing to do on your data sets, which is
Hello.
I don't know, somebody is speaking.
Yeah. I wanted to ask about the second point you made concerning the plot of points occupying an entire space.
About what?
So is it because of the uniformity that there is no hope of extracting any kind of usable information?
It's exactly because of the uniformity. So imagine that you want to compute an histogram of your data points. So already computing an histogram of your data points in two dimensions is very difficult because you need a two-dimensional grid. Imagine that you want to build an histogram in 10,000 dimensions. So then imagine that you want to build a grid in 10,000 dimensions and you have 10 grid points for each direction. So then in this case, how many grid cells would you have? You would have 10 to the power 10,000.
Yeah.
So this is an astronomically large number. There is no manner in which you can sample a probability distribution in a 10,000 dimensional space. Do you understand this?
Yeah, I understand that. So in order to be able to sample, you need some variations. Is that what I can take home?
You need, so the thing is the following, that you really need, you need some correlation between your features.
Okay.
So in order to be able to measure something in a 10-dimensional, in a 10,000-dimensional space, what you need is correlation. So then this correlation can be global, and in this case, your manifold will be a plane, an hyperplane, or it can be local. And in this case, your manifold will be this, for example, this curved manifold, which I have shown you now. Okay?
All right. So, thank you.
All right. So the feature selection challenge is extremely important in any possible application field, including material science. So the point is, given a data set with many features, one can actually define several different distance measures using subsets of these features. So for example, the distance between two different materials can be measured, for example, using their properties, let's say measured experimentally, like for example, the conductivity, the composition, the melting point, or using their electronic structure, like for example, the gap, the energy level, some response function, or I don't know, their structural properties. Also, this is something which you can compute computationally, like the phonons, defect formation free energy, like the vacancy diffusion barrier, and you name it, no? So these are all things that in principle you can either measure experimentally on your material or compute in a computer simulation, right? Then you can typically use any subset or combination of these features, right? For example, you can use only the conductivity or only the composition, or let's say the melting point and the composition. All of these combinations are in principle allowed to say if two materials are similar or not. So the thing is that So the question that you try in general, generically to address in feature selection is finding a subset of features and then which allow basically to define a distance between or a similarity between two materials, which is built with few variables, but is actually capable of predicting all the others. So this is like the rolling ring of features. So here you have, let's say, so here I didn't even tell you that such a distance necessarily exists, but one would really dream to be able to find out what are, let's say, the properties that can be, for example, in the electronic structure, on the, in the structure of properties, which are actually, for example, capable to predict conductivity, melting point, if the system is a superconductor or not, all of these things. Like, the, let's say, the ruling description of your material. So is it possible to do this? Okay, so let's try to make an example. Here, so let's say that here I have a database with the two features, X and Y, and then I have two categories, red and blue. So here, okay, so if you have, if you are in such a condition, let's say that I force you to throw away either X or Y, would you throw away X or Y? Somebody wants to make a bet. So I really say, I really want to keep either only X or only Y. Which of the two would you throw away? Somebody wants to try? So if not, I give you the answer. So here, you see, if I throw away, if I keep only Y, I can draw here a line which is perfectly able to separate the blue points from the red points, right? If instead I throw away, if I throw away, if I keep X, if I keep X, well, here, as you can see, the best manner of separating the red from the blue points is this line here. And here I will have an error, this point here, and three errors here. So here in this specific case, the correct answer is that I should throw away X and keep Y. Okay, so here this is actually a sentence which I have stolen from Wikipedia. So good feature subsets contain features highly correlated with the classification, yet uncorrelated to each other. So here in this specific case, I have shown you how a good feature, which is in this case is Y, is highly correlated with the red and blue classification. So here, feature selection approaches actually are strongly based on this observation, which I have drawn now. Clear? I hope so. So now let's go back to this example. And now let's try to do a feature selection unsupervised. So here I have removed the red and the blue colors. Now, is it possible to tell, looking at this data, if it is better X or Y? Well, the answer, well, at least according to my visual capabilities, the answer is no. There is no way of keeping X or keeping Y. Because, well, they are, so if you don't put the colors on these data points, well, both X and Y look equally important, right? So is it generally the case? Look at these data points now here. So in these data points, now, would you keep X or would you keep Y? Here I tell you that even if these data points don't have a category, don't have a color, there is an optimal option. So here, one of the two variables is better than the other. Would you be able to tell me here in this case if X is better or Y is better? Does anybody want to try? Okay, so if you don't want to try, I tell you that, where are we? So here in this case, okay. In this case, the answer is that the best variable to keep is Y. Now I'm going to show you why. Okay, so here, let's say that I have a fully informative distance, which is, let's say, the Cartesian distance between two data points. Now, if I keep only Y, basically, let's say that I want to predict if my points are close, then I look at a stripe around this central point here. So here, if I look at this stripe, I realize that if the distance in Y is small, also the distance in X is small, right? If instead I keep only X, and then I look at a stripe of points which are close by along X, what I have is that if the distance in X is small, the distance in Y can be large. Like, for example, here I have these data points here, which are close according to X, but are far according to Y. Is it clear? So here, this means that the information brought by X and Y is different. Y is informative with respect to X. X is not fully informative with respect to Y. Okay? So there is an asymmetric information content. This actually means that Y predicts X while X does not predict Y. So here I would like to be sure that this distinction is clear to everybody. If it's not clear, please ask. So I assume, so here I see something on the chat. Yeah? Please go ahead.
I wanted to know, you mentioned that Y predicts X, but X does not predict Y, but if we check the diagram on the left, it looks like both of them could predict each other up to some point, but it fails after the
okay. So here it is. Yeah. So here, if I tell you the value of Y and I look at the nearest neighbors of Y,
yeah.
The nearest neighbors according to Y are also nearest neighbors according to X. Do you agree?
Yes.
Now I look at the nearest neighbors of this point.
Okay.
According to X. So yeah. Some of these nearest neighbors are this, but some of the nearest neighbors are this, correct?
Okay. Yes.
And are these guys close along Y?
Yeah, they are close along Y.
Well, are they close to the blue point?
No.
No. All right. So this means that X does not predict Y.
Okay.
Does not predict Y. So the closeness here I should write more properly that the fact of being close along Y,
yeah,
is predictive on the fact that I am close along X, while okay, the reverse is not true. Okay.
Okay. Yes. Thank you very much.
All right. Good.
Hello, sir.
Yes. Hello, sir.
Yes, sir. Hello, sir.
So there is another question.
Other question.
You know, I don't think the religion. I think also was
and so fast, look how come we explain. My wife was on so fast.
I'm not sure I have understood the question.
E si va, no?
C'è di
I cannot hear you.
I think it's a distraction, it's not a question.
Pardon? Is
it? It's a distraction, it's not a question.
Can you please mute yourself?
Hello, a question.
And
then
okay, no questions. Okay, so here, okay, let me skip this part because it's... okay. So basically, sorry, if you don't mute yourself, I will not be able to because it's very distracting. So let me try to mute you. Okay, participants. All right. Okay. Okay, now. Okay, so now I can finally speak. Okay, right. Good. Okay. So. So now here there are tools which allow you to measure the relative information of two different descriptions. So here there are actually some examples which I want to show you. So in this case, basically the information brought by these two different descriptions A and B is symmetric, namely A predicts B and B predicts A. So these two descriptions are equivalent. So here, this is the example that I have shown you before, where I have that A predicts B, but B does not predict A. And here there is no relation. Here, so basically I give you information on B, so this information does not propagate in A. I have no constraints. And here, this case is the case in which A and B share some information, but are not equivalent. Okay, so these are, let's say, four pretty typical examples of how two different descriptions can be related with each other. Let's say the most important one is actually this one. So this one comes from the fact that my data points are live on a manifold which is non-linear. So here, if my manifold is linear, I cannot be in this condition here. In order to be in this condition, I must have that my manifold must be curved and twisted. Okay, so here basically.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
The feature on the B part of the feature, that's the second feature.
Yeah.
Where you say A predicts B and B does not predict A. Does it mean that the data outside the line are unimportant?
No, well, it means that it doesn't mean that they are not important. It means that if you want to do a feature selection, no, let's not forget that what we want to do is feature selection. So what we want to do is we have a database with 10 different features. Let's say, for example, I don't know, the phonon peak at a given K, and then the vacancy diffusion free energy and 10 others. And you want to predict, for example, the thermal conductivity. So this means that you look at two of these features, and these features, you find out that one is able to predict the other, but not vice versa. This means that you can throw away one of the two.
Okay.
Let's really, even if we are not going to show you everything, but So what we really want to do is feature selection. So what we want to do is, given a data set with many, many different features, we want to throw away some of these features and keep only a few. And here I have shown you that if I have labels, then I can try to basically keep the features which most correlate with the classification. If I don't have labels, there are still cases in which I can do feature selection. Like in this case, I can keep only Y and throw away X. Okay, so here, so now I'm going actually to show you what you can do with this feature selection procedure. So here, this thing I didn't explain you, so I'm going to skip. So let's say that I have a silicon cluster. I have a silicon cluster and I have a description of this silicon cluster, which includes 300 coordinates. So these coordinates are the so-called SOAP descriptors. Here you can trivially think about the SOAP descriptors as like, let's say, the coordinates of the atoms. Okay, now, so the question that we try to address is, can the system be described with, say, only two coordinates? So here, basically, what you do is basically you try to do feature selection computing an observable which tells you if these two coordinates or one coordinate is predictive with respect to all the others. And then you do basically a feature selection. So here, basically, this is a protocol which one can run, where you basically first keep a single coordinate and you see if this is predictive. Then you keep two, then you keep three, and then you keep four. And then basically, in this case, you find out that this specific system can be optimally described using only eight coordinates. So here you basically go from 300 features to only eight coordinates, and then you use these eight variables, these eight coordinates, to fit a predictive model. Okay, so this is a typical procedure that can do in material science. The first, you start with a description with 300 numbers, and then you have to find a manner of keeping only, let's say, in this case, only eight coordinates. So at the beginning, you don't know how many you can keep, but then you add one by one. You say that one is not enough, two is not enough, three is not enough. And then when you arrive to eight, basically you are at convergence, and then you can build your predictive model. So here in this case, so this is something that shows that the quality of your regression model basically becomes very good when you include 16 variables. When you include 16 variables, which is a little bit more than the eight which I told you, but so this actually means that you can do that feature selection is typically extremely beneficial for building your model. Okay, so here, so this is another example on a peptide, which I'm not going to show you. So here, let's say the take-home message from this first part which I have told you is that when you have a database with many features, it's very beneficial to do a preliminary feature selection on your database before doing anything else. This feature selection, if your database is labeled, so if you have categories, then you have a class of approaches which allow you to do, let's say, supervised feature selection, which means feature selection which allow you to better predict your categories. But even if your database is not labeled, so you don't have specific labels on your data points, there are approaches which allow you to do feature selection. So these approaches are approaches for unsupervised feature selections, which are somehow all rooted on this observation here, that there are cases in which one variable is simply better than the other because it allows you to perform a prediction on B while the reverse is not true. In this case, you can safely throw away B. So using these approaches, it is possible to do, let's say, feature compression. And this is what you have to keep in mind, that there are approaches which allow you to do feature compression. And then you can have approaches which allow you to do feature compression in a supervised manner or in an unsupervised manner. Here, needless to say that I didn't explain you how you have to do it, but something that you can keep in mind is that these approaches exist in such a way that if you then in your real world application, you end up to a database with too many features, you'll know that you actually can do feature selections before attempting anything else. All right? Okay, so this thing closes the first thing that I wanted to tell you. I don't know if you have questions on this first part.
Doctor?
Yeah?
Yeah, I have a question. Could you please explain what is the difference between feature engineering and feature selection?
Feature what?
A difference between feature engineering and a feature selection.
Okay, feature engineering is defining new features which are functions of the features that you have already, which are according to your knowledge particularly meaningful. Okay, so here a typical example of feature engineering is when you try to build a complicated function of your features, which is able to predict something. So this means that you have, let's say, 10 features, and then you try to build a function of these features, which is useful for your prediction. Okay? This is feature engineering in the way of understanding. Feature selection means that you have your 10 features, and you try to end up with only 2 features, and then you want to throw away 8. So the advantage of feature selection is that the features that you keep are typically interpretable. So you have, like, for example, you have 8-10 features to start with, and then you throw away 8, and you keep only two features. These features will be, for example, the melting point and the thermal conductivity, for example. So these two features are interpretable. If instead you do feature engineering, you end up maybe with a single feature which is able to predict everything, but this feature will be a complicated function of all the other features. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
I see another question from Gladys.
Yes, I would wish to inquire. When we are looking at two features that you've explained, like for A and B, or for X and Y, I think that can be easily visualized. But like in the example you were giving as well, you had a very large data set.
This is a very good question. So here, of course, the approaches, so this approach that I used here is not based on visualization. So this you need, in order to do this feature selection, you have an algorithm. So this algorithm is automatic and it is based on computing, basically, well, something which is related with the cross entropy between the two descriptions. I didn't describe you what you have to do because this would take me an hour. So here, the scope of this lecture, so I cannot go into the technical details because otherwise I would need many, many lectures. So here I just wanted to give you ideas, but this is a very, very good point. Of course, you don't do it by visual inspection. You do it by computing a quantity, which we call information imbalance, which is defined here, is the average of the ranks according to distance B of the first neighbor according to distance A. This thing is automatic, is computed totally automatic. So this thing is what we call machine learning. It's not something that you do with visual inspection. If you want to have more details on how we do this thing, you can write to me and I can send you a reference, okay?
Okay, thank you.
But thanks for this question. This question is very, very important because otherwise you would have been misled. All right. Okay. If there are no more questions, so actually I want, so maybe I want to tell you about something about, something which actually goes in the direction of what your colleague called feature engineering. So feature engineering means, exactly what we were saying. Namely, you start from your initial set of features and you try to build other features which are functions of these features that you had at the beginning. Okay, so here, maybe one thing that we can do is, I think I'm out of time for this first lecture. So let's say that if you don't mind, we can now take a break. We can take a break and we can reconvene at 20 past 11, okay? So we take a 20 minutes break. Fine?
Fine, perfect. So thank you.
All right, so we take a 20 minutes break and then I will talk about dimensional reduction and clustering, okay?
Yeah, thank you. Alessandro, yeah. Please, the next talk will be a different one, right?
The next talk will be?
A different one. Do you want us to make one continuous recording or to break it?
Maybe we can stop the recording, but let's make a continuous recording. It's better to make just one recording. Now you can pause the recording and then we continue it when we reconvene, okay?
Yeah, so I'll pause it now, yeah.
All right, okay, so now, in this second part of my lecture, I will mention some other key methods in data analysis and in particular in unsupervised learning. So the first method that which I want to mention is let's say the hydrogen atom of feature engineering, where hydrogen atom simply means the simplest and the most well-known method, which is a principal component analysis. So the idea in principal component analysis is that in practice, in many cases, like for example, this case here, where I have a two-dimensional database, I have, let's say, an almost perfect linear correlation between the two, and therefore, actually, it is more, it is possible to describe this database using a single variable, which basically is along the direction of the data. So this is the key idea, the basis of principal component analysis. No, so here in this case, the optimal description of this database will be this red axis here, which is actually called the first principal component, and then the direction orthogonal to this main principal component is described by a second variable, which is this U2, which is orthogonal to that. So how do you obtain this description? So you obtain this description basically just by performing a rotation. So you take this database here, and then you represent your data in the new axis, in the red axis, which are these ones and that one. So if you notice now, also the origin has been shifted. So here in this representation, the origin is here. Now the origin becomes here. Okay, so how do you do that? So given n observations of an m-dimensional column vector, well, you first of all compute the mean of each component, and then you compute the covariance matrix, which is this quantity here. So you basically, from each data, you subtract the mean, and then you compute. So here, I'm sorry, here this should be xj. So this is xi minus, these are vector operations. So this is correct. All right. So then you compute the eigenvalue, eigenvector pairs, and you sort the eigenvectors in decreasing order. And then you choose the number of dimensions in which to project the data. And then you finally do the projection. So the projection will just be the projection of your data on the eigenvectors of the covariance matrix. So here in this specific case, you have a two-dimensional data. Then you will have two eigenvalues. So the eigenvalues quantifies the variance explained by each component. So in this case, you will have an eigenvalue, a large eigenvalue lambda one, and a smaller eigenvalue lambda two. So the eigenvalues have a direct interpretation in this case, and this direct interpretation is the variance explained by this specific component. Okay, so the eigenvectors simply define the direction. So they will be U1 pointing in this direction and U2 pointing in this second direction here. How do you choose the number of components? So basically, it is a critical choice in principal component analysis, because if you use all the components, you have not performed a dimensional reduction. So if you have initially 10 features and you take and you choose 10 components, then you will simply have a database which also has 10 features, so zero win. So how do you choose the components? So the simplest manner is looking for a gap in the eigenvalues. So if you have, so this is a plot where you show the eigenvalues in decreasing order. So this is actually the logarithm of the eigenvalue in a specific application. And here you actually see that the leading eigenvalue is 9.5 in logarithmic units, and then you have a small gap to 8.5. Then you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 other eigenvalues. And then you have a significant gap in logarithmic scale. So it's really a significant gap. And then you have all the other eigenvalues. So in this case, the correct number of components which you should use is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Okay? Clear? So if so this is, let's say, the first manner of choosing the number of components in your principal components analysis, looking for a gap. So the other manner is the percentage of variance explained. So basically here, if you keep only the first D eigenvalues, basically you will explain a fraction of the variance, which will be the sum from 1 to D of lambda I divided by the sum from 1 to the number of features of lambda I. So this number is always smaller than 1. So you can say that you choose D in such a way that you basically, with your the components that you are using, you explain, let's say, 90% of the variance. So this is a less principled manner of choosing the number of components than looking for a gap, but is a very, very meaningful one. But okay, so in short, really, really short, principal component analysis. In principal component analysis, you do a linear change of variables in such a way that the variables that you are keeping is able to explain a large fraction of the variance of your data. Okay? So this I'm not going very much into the details of that, because this is a method that I'm sure that you have already seen. Here I simply want to move to what are the problems of principal component analysis, because this is more relevant. So clearly, so if my manifold containing my data is non-linear, is curved like this one, then principal component analysis here in this case cannot work, no, because I cannot transform. If I perform a rotation on the axis for this database, I'm really not able to do a meaningful dimensional reduction. And so there are many other methods which actually form the core of what it is called the nonlinear manifold learning, which actually allow to unwrap your data manifold. So if you have your data manifold that looks like that, so in this method, what you're actually doing is ironing your data manifold in such a manner that it becomes flat and can be described by two coordinates. One will be this and the other will be that. So here there are many methods of different complexity, starting from kernel PCA, diffusion map, local linear embedding, isomap, and also partially the sketch map approach, which allow really to do this thing of ironing your data manifold. All right. So actually, real world data in many practical applications can be actually nasty, in the sense that they actually live on manifold which are not only curved and twisted, but curved and twisted would still mean that the manifold can be ironed, but can also be topologically complex. What does it mean, topologically complex? Let me see if I can find quickly. Ah, yeah, here it is. So topologically complex means that my data manifold looks like that, no? So I am closing it in this manner, no? So this is topologically complex. It means that there is no manner in which I can iron it. In order to iron it to a manifold, I have to break it. So I have to break it here. So if I break it, then I am able to iron it, but this will mean that the data points which are physically close to each other, because my manifold looks like that, will be actually, in order to iron it, I have to break it and make them far apart. So in this case, dimensional reduction implies, well, in a way, breaking my data manifold. This thing actually poses a very, very severe challenge to the manifold learning approaches. So these are the, let's say, this is the direction, research lines, which I mainly follow in my group, which is developing approaches which allow to learn something on your data manifold when your data manifold cannot be ironed. So here, today I didn't really talk about what we are doing, because this is an overview talk. Okay, I don't know if there are questions on this short part of my presentation here. So what are the take-home messages? The take-home messages is that in real world data sets, well, the first thing that you typically try to do is feature selection, which is the thing that I told you in the previous hour. But even after you do feature selection, you typically end up with too many features. And then what you have to do is an explicit dimensional reduction. So dimensional reduction is something which is it doesn't exist a single method which works for all the data sets. So this dimensional reduction is what your colleague called, let's say, feature engineering. No, so it's actually starting from a description in one space and ending up with a much lower dimensional description in another space. So the simplest example of dimensional reduction is a principal component analysis, which is a linear method. Here there is a zoo of other dimensional reduction techniques, which in some cases allow you to iron your surface. You have to take care of the fact that in many cases, surfaces cannot be ironed, because they are topologically complex. And there you have a zoo of possible manners of addressing these problems. All right? Even in principal component analysis, the features that you obtained are basically combinations of your original features. So in principal component analysis, they are linear combinations. So in more complicated methods, they are nonlinear and nonlinear combinations of your features, so are very difficult to interpret. So this is another very, very important problem of dimensional reduction. You typically end up with a description of your data set, which is typically very compact. You have only few features, but these features are not easy to interpret. So they do not allow a direct and simple interpretation. Okay, maybe I don't know if you have questions on this part. I would actually, I think the most important take home message is this decision tree that you have here, which actually tells you how complicated the zoo of dimensional reduction techniques is. All right. So if there are no questions, I'm actually going to move to the next and the most important, maybe most important part of my presentation, which is...
I have a question.
Yes.
Yeah, I would like to know this dimensional reduction, the feature selection and followed by dimensional reduction of data. Mm-hmm. Will not it affect the final result? Well, final result.
The final, so they, it should not affect, if you talk about the final result, let's say that the final result is a predictor of the property of your system, right? Let's say that this is your final result, for example, no? Or for example, a predictor of the energy of your system, of the forces of your system, or of some property of your system. Then clearly feature selection and dimensional reduction should not affect this final result. Otherwise, your feature selection and your dimensional reduction has not been performed correctly. So this is actually a very, very important observation that one has to do. So if one has a target, you judge on the quality of your dimensional reduction by the fact that this dimensional reduction should not affect your prediction. In principle, should improve your prediction. Because if you do an appropriate feature selection or dimensional reduction, you throw away noise. Throw away noise means that your predictor will be, in principle, better. Is it clear?
Okay, thank you.
All right. Okay, now, so I'm going to, for the rest of my lecture, I am going to talk about an approach which you can use even if your data manifold is very complex. So clustering is something that you can, is basically an unsupervised learning technique, which you can use even if the manifold containing the data is not isomorphic to an hyperplane. Okay, clustering. So, well, here, a very important message that I want to convey is that clustering doesn't have to do with classification in general. So because basically clustering in general is an unsupervised learning technique, which in general generates groups. It generates groups of similar data. Classification is something which you can do if you have, let's say, ground truth labels, like blue and red in the previous data set which I have shown. So these two things are conceptually very different. Okay, so why clustering? So basically, clustering allows basically to, let's say, split a collection of stones according, for example, to their colors. We end up with the colors, well, with the stones which are all look the same. So this thing can be done without any ground truth label. So using, for example, only the light wavelength in this specific case, no? Okay, so what is a cluster? So here I'm now going to show you a few examples of two-dimensional data sets where everybody would tell what a cluster is. So in this case, the two clusters will be these ones, right? Two groups of data points which look similar. So now in this case, here are clusters. Here I am coloring different clusters in this other database according to the color. This is another example. And this is another example. So in this case, this is the less trivial example because here I have a background and then I have clouds of data points, which form what we call density peaks. And here, as you can see, I have a color for each cluster, and then the background is colored in black. So in this case, the clusters are these density peaks which emerge from this background. But now, so let's try to go to be a little bit more specific on what a cluster is. So now if you look at these data points here, the definition of what a cluster is a little bit more ambiguous than in the examples that I have shown you before. Let's say, well, for sure, if we would do like a poll among you, among the audience, everybody would agree that here, this is a cluster and this is a cluster. So this database can be meaningfully split in this manner, right? But then, okay, so then here, one can say that also, so then if I really go a little bit more into details, then I can actually think to split this cluster here into two, because here these are, so this region has, let's say, a lower density. So I will have a cluster here and another cluster here, okay? And I can do the same on this side here. I can say that this is a cluster because here this is separated by a density gap here, and this is another cluster. And then I can do both things together. And then I can find a further level of refinement where I have this cluster, this cluster, this cluster, and then this cluster here. So in total, let's say at the highest level of resolution, in this database, I can say that I have five clusters, no? Okay, so here, so this example and the previous example tell us already a lot about clustering. So the result of a clustering procedure depends on what you define to be a cluster. So it depends also on how you define the distance between data, and of course it depends on the features that you have selected, no? So here in this case I have shown you what happens if you have only two features, but as we have seen in the previous part of my lecture, it is very, very important to select in advance the feature that you are using to do your analysis, no? So you have you have all these ambiguities that in a way have to be addressed before performing your clustering analysis. So you are a little bit in trouble. So like in all the methods in numerical analysis, you have actually no black boxes. There are many choices that you have to do in advance before performing your analysis. Okay, so here let's try to make to give a general overview on clustering approaches. So a main classification of clustering approaches is basically a classification between flat, fuzzy, and hierarchical clustering. So Flat clustering performs a hard partition of the data. So basically you have just one label for each data point. Fuzzy clustering, in fuzzy clustering, you have that the assignment of each data point is in probability. So basically each data point will not necessarily belong to a cluster, but it will belong to, let's say, three clusters. And then I will so each data point will come together with a fraction a probability of belonging to cluster one, two, or three. So this is most of the modern clustering approaches are actually fuzzy. And then hierarchical clustering, instead of generating a single partition, generates a tree in which basically the clusters are arranged in a hierarchical fashion. We are now going to see an example. So in this case, in the case of the example that I have shown you before, in flat clustering, I have just a label. This is cluster one, cluster two, cluster three, cluster four, and cluster five. One thing that has to be noticed is that in many algorithms, the number of clusters, K, is a meta parameter, namely a parameter that has to be chosen by the user. Okay, so in hierarchical clustering, basically I have a hierarchy. So here, as you can see, the result of clustering is a tree like that, where the final cluster actually corresponds to these branches, but the result comes in the form of something which is a tree. Therefore, I can then decide at which level I am going to cut my tree. So if I cut it at this level, I will have only two clusters, this and this. If I cut it at this level, I will have three clusters, and so on. Okay? So in general, hierarchical clustering produces a set of nested clusters organized as a hierarchical tree and can be visualized as a dendrogram. So this is usually a very, very useful manner of visualizing your data. So the advantage of hierarchical clustering is that it is not necessary to make any assumption on the number of clusters, because this typically you decide a posteriori by looking at your dendrogram how many clusters you meaningfully have in your database. Okay, it can be transformed into an hard card partition by cutting the tree. So you cut it here and then you have two clusters, you cut it here, you have three clusters, and you cut it here and you have one, two, three, four, five, and six clusters. Clear? Please ask any clarification. Here, this is just an overview, but I would like at least to be clear the difference between flat clustering and hierarchical clustering. Clear? Very good.
There's a question in the audience, Alessandro.
Yes, please go ahead.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
My question is in supervised. We know that you're classified by labeling. So what guides the clustering? How do you define?
This is an excellent question, which I am going to address. At the end of the talk, but since I don't know how much time I will have, address it immediately. Okay, so the thing is the following, this is a typical analysis pipeline, which I follow. So that's what I do typically. So so this analysis pipeline includes a part which is unsupervised, which is starting from the data samples. Then you typically do a feature selection, for example, using the approaches which I have described, well, not really described, but hinted in the first part of my talk. And then you do clustering. So clustering is performed without using the labels. Then, well, then this is where the labels start playing a role. So basically you do validation. So you actually try to understand if the clusters which you have found are meaningful or not. So this thing is very, very important. So, and then what does it mean meaningful? So meaningful means, for example, that your clusters must have the same label. Here we are going to actually, so there is a manner of understanding if this is true or not, which I'm going to explain you in a second. But let's say, so if the clusters that you find are not meaningful for any reason, then you have basically to go back there. Maybe you can repeat the clustering with other meta parameters or a different approach, or even there. So maybe your cluster are not meaningful because you have thrown away too many features. So you have to go back here and maybe add another feature. And then at a certain point you will be happy. And then you have a model in which you have groups of data with similar properties, where similar means, for example, similar labels. And this is where the domain specific expertise comes into the game. No? So there you will need to use your expertise to provide an interpretation of the model that you have been able to build. And so this is actually what creates knowledge. So what allows you, for example, to suggest how to design a new material or suggest how to perform a new experiment. Okay, so this is, let's say, the general analysis pipeline, and unsupervised learning actually enters into this first part here. When you then use the labels, when you start using the labels, basically you enter into supervised learning or validation. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. But my question, can you hear me, sir? Hello? Hello, sir?
Yes, I'm listening.
Okay. My question is, how do you define the features? How do you define when you want to cluster your data points? How do you define the clusters, each cluster? Since it is not labeled and it's not supervised, how do you define the features of your clusters? And okay. Second question, sir.
The answer to your question is on this slide that I have put on now, which I wanted to show afterwards. But I'm going to show it now. So the question is, so here what you want to, so let's say that your clustering approach simply splits your data set in, let's say, for example, only two clusters. So here in this up to this moment, so you have just two different groups of data, cluster one and cluster two. So now you have to understand if these two classes are useful and meaningful or not. So here, so if you have labels, what you can do is to check if your clusters include the data in which the labels are uniform. So let's say that you have here in this case, you have four clusters and two labels, okay? Oranges and apples. Here you will see that, for example, this cluster includes only oranges, right? So this is a good cluster. This includes only labels, only apples. So this is also a good cluster. But here, for example, this cluster includes five oranges and two apples, okay? So here you would say that this clusters is not perfect. So one can actually say, okay, here I don't like this clustering partition, so I have to add another feature until I get only clusters which include only oranges or only apples. Okay, and then I have basically to go back here. For example, I have to add another feature and repeat my clustering until I don't get only clusters which include only apples or only oranges. Is this clear now?
Yes, sir. I think, I don't know if this answers this second question. For instance, when you are clustering your data points, I don't know if it is strictly that each data point will appear in the specified cluster, or does it mean that one data point can appear in two clusters? And if it can appear in clusters, how do you separate it so that it will be in the appropriate cluster?
So the thing is that your question, okay, so there, this depends on the clustering algorithm which you are using. So if you are using flat clustering, basically each element is assigned to a single cluster, okay? Then in this case, you can directly check if your clustering partition is consistent with the ground truth labels that you have. Is it clear?
So.
Now, if you are doing hierarchical clustering, in principle, you can try to check by cutting the tree at different heights if your clustering partition is accurate. So here, let's say that here you have some apples and some oranges. It can happen that if you cut here at this level here, you will have that your clusters, which will be 1, 2 and 3 will not be pure, okay? And then you basically lower the level of the cut until you find clusters which are pure. So in hierarchical clustering, you have a manner of basically varying the level of your partition until you don't find clusters which are, let's say, consistent with your ground truth labels. The thing is that, of course, since in a clustering approach, you want to create understanding, you don't want to have too many clusters, right? In principle, you would like to have as few clusters as possible, no? And then, so let's say if you cut here at this level, it's true that you will have clusters which will be for sure pure. But these clusters will be so many that it will be useless. So also in this case, you have to find a compromise between the number of clusters and the fact that you want to have clusters which are compliant with your ground truth label. Okay?
Sorry, sir. Please, what guides us in choosing the different clustering algorithms?
Okay, so, well, the thing is that so here, in order to answer to this question, I have to first explain you at least another, to give you an example of another clustering algorithm. So please let me explain you another clustering algorithm, and then I promise to go back to this question, okay?
Thank you, sir.
All right. So, but now I have to put the, my battery is expiring, so please just wait 1 minute that I have to find the charger of my laptop. 1 minute.
Professor, sorry, sir. Can I ask one more question?
He's searching for the connect for the plugin for his laptop.
Plugin for my thing, otherwise I'm going to, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, good. Okay. Okay, so now I'm going to introduce
more. Hello, sir. Hello, yes. Prof. Sorry, can we use clustering for prediction?
Absolutely, yes. Because, so if you, so basically, because clustering you typically performed using the features, and then you can have that only part of your data set is labeled, okay? So this means that you cluster all the data, but then you say that the label, so you basically predict the label of the data points where you have no labels by saying that the label of this data point with no label is the same label of the other data points which belong to the same cluster. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Can you put again your slide with the colors, Alessandro?
This one?
Yeah, but for instance. So basically what Alessandro says is that if you have a point that's here, then you're going to say that it belongs to this class. If it's here, it belongs to this other class and so on. Okay.
So how do you identify, like when you mentioned you use orange and apple, if orange data point goes to apple,
you have to know in advance the labels, because otherwise.
Okay. So let's say that, imagine that now some of these black colors, only some of these black points are colored. Imagine that like I have half of these points which are black, which are blue, and other, some of these points are red. Now imagine that this is red, this is red, this is red. This is red, and these three are black. Then you would be able to say that also these three data points are likely to be red, okay? Because you sort of say that the label of this, which is red, 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 make it very likely that also the other, so the label of the other data points which belong to the same cluster are likely to be red. This is how you do prediction by clustering, okay?
There's another question. Yeah, I think it's clear. There's another question in the audience.
Yes.
I'm gonna repeat it. So the question is, how can you measure the similarity between the data points?
Well, typically you use just a Cartesian distance computed using the features. So it's just the distance using the features which you have selected.
So do you get it?
So, do you understand?
Yeah, I think
that is why we know that the data point belongs to the subgroup. Then you measure the distance between the data point.
Okay, so I'm going to answer the question. Let's say that it's two features here only. Okay, so you know features that are associated to your points. Okay, and so you can put the point here and you see where it is. And so as Alessandro was saying, you can measure a distance if you know the coordinates of the two features x and y, then you know the distance from these points here and you can measure that, okay?
Does it depend on the clustering algorithm?
No, the distance, no.
Okay.
Unless you do a PCA and you work with the principal components of the points, okay?
Yeah.
So you can also measure the similarity without...
Yes, I mean, some you have to be careful with that, okay? Because sometimes you have features that are on completely different scales. So you may have to renormalize the features in such a way that you get the distance there. It's always a bit complicated, but indeed that's one way. Okay, and let's take it for instance, an example. If you have just the composition of a system, so you have this atom as, this material has some nickel in it, this other one has some lead in it, or this one has iron in it. So how do you measure the distance when it's different things like that? So sometimes the distance can be complicated. There are papers about that, okay? So I mean, we don't want to go into these details here, but the main idea is that one. So it's the distance, the Euclidean distance between the vector that describes the features of your points.
Yeah. One thing that has to be also remarked that if you have only two features, you can always plot one as a function of the other and directly see by eye if there are clusters or not, okay? But in typical applications, you have not two features, but you have 10 or more. And then in this case, you cannot simply look at your data in a meaningful projection. So this is the reason why you need algorithms to extract clusters, okay?
Yeah, so there's a few more questions, Alessandro. So I think it's 1, 2, and then 3 there, okay? Let's do that. Okay, you can run with your question.
Okay, my question is, when you have a large data set and you succeed in clustering, for instance, if it is a data set of fruits, as he has mentioned, maybe we have apple, orange, pineapple, and all that. When you finish clustering, how do you identify that a cluster is a data point of orange? Can you walk back to know that this cluster is for orange, or how do you identify the clusters?
Did you hear the question, Alessandro?
Well, so this, I think I heard it. So the thing is, maybe if I would have a blackboard, it would be extremely easy to answer. So probably.
Alessandro, at the top where you have view options, I think you can annotate the slides.
Yeah. This I know, but well.
At the bottom, you have a whiteboard also.
Okay, so here, so let me try to connect to. I don't know because I have an iPad, but I would take 5 minutes to connect. So I will try to annotate the slide. All right. So here, so let's say that I have, let's use this one. Data points, which are here, and here, and then I have other data points which are there. Okay. Clustering algorithms are typically agnostic on the labels. So here I have a circle and a cross, but in clustering algorithm, you don't know if these are circles of cross to start with. Okay, then what? So I lost my mouse. Just a second. There is a problem here. Sorry, I'm not able to draw anymore. Why there is a problem with I think here I have really, really a problem with the, okay, now I think I see this thing. Okay. Okay. So in my, in a clustering algorithm, I typically, so now, oh, come on. So next, so annotate, all right. So in a clustering algorithm here, I will typically obtain just a partition. Let's say that I have a cluster here and another cluster there, okay? So these are my two clusters. And then basically what I can do is, a posteriori I can use the labels. And here I will find that, for example, this class, I have a cluster that, yeah, it's once again stuck. Okay. No, I'm really sorry, but I have a problem with my, okay. 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 So here I will have a cluster which will be, will contain only apples, and the cluster which will contain apples and oranges. And therefore I can evaluate a posteriori if my part, my clustering partition is good or not. But the important thing is that in order to perform clustering, I do not use the labels, okay? I only use the features. Okay, so let's make another example. See here, I'm afraid that this will actually bring me very, very quickly to the end of my talk because the time is running out very quickly. So imagine that I have a material science database with 10 features which are related with electronic structure calculation. So imagine like something describing, for example, the electronic structure property of my, of each of 100 materials. Then I can do clustering based on these features. And then after I have my cluster, I can actually use labels. For example, labels can be, this material is superconducting or not. And then I can actually try to see if my clusters are correlated with these labels. Like for example, I will be very happy if I have, for example, two clusters, one including materials which are superconducting and the other which contain material which are not. If I have found something like that, I will immediately apply for the Nobel Prize. For this will not happen probably, but so let's say that this is an ideal scenario in which I have performed clustering using some features, and then these clusters happen to be pure with respect to the labels which I want to predict. Okay?
Yeah.
Did I clarify a little bit what is going on? So there are other questions?
Yeah, there are other questions, but I'm not sure that, we still don't know what is it that's the problem?
What I want to know is, assuming that you finish clustering,
which is the case here,
yes.
Okay?
Can you identify that this cluster belongs to orange?
No, you have to know the labels in advance. I mean, here, when you draw
okay,
the
okay,
cluster.
You use,
no, you don't use it to do the clustering,
okay.
But you know it.
Okay.
So you do the clustering as if you didn't know it.
Okay.
And afterwards, you look. So in the example that's here, you see Alessandro drew the clusters, okay?
Okay?
And then you realize, yes, this cluster has all of them that are
okay.
Circles.
Okay.
This one is crossing and a few squares.
Okay, the same one. Identify
yes, the labels.
Okay.
So in this case, for instance, these would be oranges and these would be
okay.
apples. Okay. You need to have a label to then do something with that. Okay. And also, sometimes it may also be interesting to see that even without knowing what it is, that sometimes you have a bunch of data that are clustering in one way and some others are clustering in a different way. It may be useful. then I mean, it's up to you to see what is common between all these data and what is common between these all other data. Okay? Yes, your question there?
Yeah. My question was related to the using of the Lydian instance. I can see that two data points are similar if the Lydian instance between them is zero.
It's close, it's small. So the question, yes. Alessandro, is.
So it is disclosed or zero?
I mean, that's something that's arbitrary. So the question is, when you take the Euclidean distance and that you define the similarity based on Euclidean the distance, can we say the two points are similar when the distance between them is zero? But I said that when they are close, so that the distance is small, but there is some arbitrariness to that.
So it's a meaning of that there is arbitrariness in that. So
okay, if we take again the example of the labels, yes. So you could say, I mean, there are points that are going to be at the same distance from one cluster and the other. So for those points, you don't know. I mean, in some cases, when you're very close to all the points that were oranges, then you can say, okay, my new point is going to be an orange. When you're close to the apples, then you're going to say my new point is an apple. But if the two points, if it's in between them,
So, excuse me, in that example of apples and oranges, when I wanted to draw fishes, fishes. Yeah.
Sorry.
So we use coordinates.
X and Y, yes.
Yeah.
The features, okay.
Yeah, features. So what are the features here exactly? It is a color and kind.
I mean, it's something that you have to define in advance, the feature. So you have to think about what describes the sample that you have. So I don't know, in the case of the oranges and the apple, you may want to say, okay, the features are the size, the shape, the colors. I mean, anything you can think of as a feature, just use it. And then the machine will sort and find which ones are important. Yeah, features and descriptors is exactly the same terms. Yes, Alessandro, you want to say something?
Yeah, well, let me say that in many, many cases, you have a problem with the fact that the features are heterogeneous in the sense that they have different units of measures. So imagine that you have a material where you know the melting temperature and the thermal conductivity and the absorption energy of an atom. So these are three numbers which have a totally different units of measures. So if you want to mix them in order to do a prediction, so you must basically find a manner of comparing these different scales. Let's say the simplest manner of doing that is dividing by the standard deviation of each single feature. In this manner, you'll have that all the features will have the same dimension. No? So they will all be dimensionless. But this is a key difficulty in unsupervised machine learning, which has been only partial, where there is still a lot of work to do, let me say. So comparing features which have different units of measures. But after you have, let's say, in some manner solved this problem, the distance between two different data points is computed using the Cartesian distance, just the distance between the feature vectors.
It was yet another question at the back. Do you still have a question or it's all clear now? Yes.
My question is about how you know the evaluation of the best car.
The best what?
Car means car.
Okay, best K.
The best way to define, because of most of the algorithms we initialize are car. So if you want to close to group your data set, you need to define, first of all, how many clusters you. I'm asking if there's a way to generate that car before using car maps.
So I think the question, Alessandro, is there a way to define in advance the number of clusters that you want?
Well, the thing is the following,
So Omolulu is saying that indeed it may be considered as an hyperparameter.
This is absolutely correct, but in fact, in some approaches, for example, in density peak clustering, the correct number of clusters emerges from the data. So here, if you look at this data set here, well, I think everybody would say that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 clusters, right?
Yeah.
And so this thing, there are clustering approaches where this number has to be chosen and is an hyperparameter. Other clustering approaches in which instead this is a result of your clustering calculation. For example, this is the case in density peak clustering, and this is also partially the case in hierarchical clustering, because in hierarchical clustering, basically, if you see a dendrogram like that, well, you can actually pretty safely say that you have 1, 2, and 3 clusters, because if you cut here, you have a very, very clean cut between 3 branches, no? So this depends on the method that you are using. Instead, in k-means clustering, which is another very, very popular clustering approach, the number of clusters has to be chosen, is a meta parameter. I didn't explain you how this method is working, but the number of clusters is a meta parameter.
Yeah, she was actually referring to this k.
Yeah.
You have to choose this k, exactly. And there is, it's actually rather, well, it's non-trivial because, well, here in k-means, you basically, it doesn't, so if you have a structure on your data, basically you find clusters which are, let's say, compliant with the structure of your data. But now if you would look at a data set like that, how many clusters you would say that you have here? So I'm talking about the data set on the right. According to you, how many clusters do you have here?
Many clusters on this plot here.
Can you spot some clusters there? I cannot spot any cluster there. So here the answer would be one, just one cluster. But in fact, if you perform k-means and you say, I want to have 15 clusters, I'm going to find 15 clusters. That's the partition that you are going to find. So in k-means, if you ask for 15 clusters, you will always get 15 clusters. So this, because actually k-means is more a partitioning scheme than a clustering scheme, to be rigorous. Okay, unfortunately, I didn't explain you how k-means is working, and now I'm actually running out of time.
Actually, Alessandro, there's still one question. Sorry.
Yeah. I will be happy to answer to questions. If there are still some, I still have 5 minutes.
Actually, Alessandro, after you, we have a break. And then after that is Michele Cerioti. So I'll tell you there's a break for like 30 minutes. So you can continue answering the question and teaching till like 5 to 1.
Yeah. No, well, I have something to do now because I had reserved for this lecture until 12:30. I still have 5 to 10 minutes.
Okay, my question is, when you have a raw data and it is always easier to be able to do your clustering when you can visualize your data before doing the clustering, like if you have done dimensionality reduction to a dimension that you can plot, let's say you reduce it to 2 dimensions to 3 dimensions and you can plot. What of an instance where with all the dimensionality reduction you have done, you still have like a high dimensional space?
Well,
for example, then, from, then, from,
This is a very good question. In this case, you simply cannot visualize your data in two dimensions or in three dimensions. And this is exactly the scenario in which clustering becomes useful. Because this visualization that you have here, this dendrogram, okay?
Yes.
So this visualization, you can do it even if your data points live in 100 dimensions.
Yes.
And this is exactly the major competitive advantage of clustering with respect to, like for example, principal component analysis. Because in principal component analysis, you can do a dimensional reduction, but then you say, okay, in order to describe my data, I need 10 coordinates. But then how do I visualize this thing? I cannot do it. Instead, in clustering, you can visualize even very, very complex data landscapes, for example, by using a dendrogram.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Alessandro. Question? Okay, so I think we have answered all the questions. You still have time? You can...
Yes, I have time.
Okay, so go ahead.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Hello. I have again this feature selection, comparing with feature engineering. So I think the feature engineering, Dr. Omololu, he dealt in previous classes in very much detail. So in that we understood is feature engineering is a cleaning of the data. And now this is something like what your feature selection and clustering, all the things, it is something like simplifying the complex data. So just I want to know the clarification. So is it a feature selection means it's selecting the important properties in the analysis? Is it something like that?
That's what So probably I misunderstood because I don't use normally the term feature engineering. I understood that feature engineering meant building other features from the features that you have.
No, it is cleaning the data. It was dealt by Dr. Omololu in previous classes in very detail. And this feature selection, is it selecting properties, important properties, and omitting some unwanted properties?
Selecting important properties, exactly.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello, Alessandro.
Yes.
There are some questions in the chat. I don't know if you saw them.
In the chat?
Yeah.
Allora. What if you have a mirror image in the plot? Does it affect the predictions? The answer is no, it doesn't affect the prediction, because basically in most of the approaches, basically the sign of a feature is totally irrelevant. Does the dimensionality of a dataset map to the size of the feature? Yes, it's the same stuff. So the dimensionality of a dataset is exactly equal, is the just the number equal to the number of features. I don't see other questions.
Hello. Hello, excuse me.
Yes.
I have a question. It's from the little that I understood based on your talk or your lecture. I understand that in this unsupervised machine learning, it's like most of the time will be consumed in between feature selection, clustering, and validation. Am I correct?
This is absolutely correct.
All right. So my question is this.
Yeah.
if you come in a situation whereby after feature selection, you did a cluster in, you validate and you find out that this is not what you want. You have to get back to the feature selection. You do clustering again. You do validation. My question is, when will you know the appropriate time to stop?
When your, for example, in the example which I have shown, when you have found clusters which contain only oranges or only apples.
In that case, you need to visualize your data.
Not really, because okay. This is something, it's a number which you can compute, and then you will know that you have a clustering partition, which you can then use to perform predictions, which doesn't necessarily need to be visualized in two dimensions.
Okay, so is that what you mean by information imbalance?
No, this is another story. This is another story. Okay. The information imbalance is an approach for performing feature selection. It's one of the many approaches
okay.
to perform feature selection.
Sorry. Thank you very much.
But, I think you understood the pipeline is what you have sketched, what you have told. Okay?
Thank you.
All right. More questions?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Yes.
I'm interested in knowing how I could use clustering method to identify transition states, like transition state in molecular dynamics calculation that you've done and you've gathered your data, and possibly identifying your transition state or your minimum or maximum is difficult to do. Can we use clustering method to do it, and which aspect of clustering can help us to do that?
Well, there are clustering methods like density peak clustering, which find basically which basically find the density peaks and the saddle points between different density peaks. So basically, in this approach, you will find that here there is a density peak, here there is a density peak, and here you will have a saddle point between two different density peaks. And here, for example, you will have another one. So clearly, these saddle points will be the transition states in your, in your molecular dynamics. So basically, the saddle points correspond exactly. The saddle points can also be found by a clustering approach. That's the answer.
One more question, Alessandro.
Yes, please go ahead.
Hello, Prof. I'm also interested on using clustering to cluster chemical data sets.
Mm-hmm.
Based on its chemical structure. I don't know if you can help me to identify.
I think there is, first of all, defining an appropriate set of features. So there is really, really a lot of work in the literature. Well, then, first of all, it depends on which chemical space you want to consider. For example, if you want to consider, like if you have organic molecules, you have a manner of proceeding. If you talk about material science, you have a different manner of proceeding, typically, no? Like, for example, if you want to describe an organic molecule, your features must also describe the topology of this organic molecule, right? So how this is organized in rings, in side chains, and everything. Then you have features which are exactly designed to describe this topology. So in material science, typically the features that describe your chemical space are features which describe the local environment around each atom. So you have, for example, the SOP features. I don't know if Michele Ceriotti in the next lecture will talk about that. So you have a lot of incredibly important work that has been done in order to do exactly what you are asking, namely describing your chemical space with features. Now, after you have these features, then you can, well, you can do many things. Among these many things that you can also do clustering. Given these features, you can try to see if your data points, which in this case will correspond to molecules or different materials, are actually grouped in clusters. But the first key passage there is finding a correct description in terms of features. And then starting from that, you can do clustering.
Okay. Our intention is on drug discovery. And we want to cluster molecules to identify if some molecules have activity over malaria.
So this is a very, very clear. So this is an example of a case where you can, if you have many, many molecules, you can first do clustering can actually help you to basically split your data set in fewer categories which have something in common. And then you can try to see if these categories are characterized by the fact, for example, that you can be lucky and you find that one of these clusters preferentially contains molecules with antimalaric activity, and then you have understood something. So this is something that actually helps you to build what I call the knowledge. No, so that's in our pipeline here. You are at this stage here, but yes, of course, you can use unsupervised learning technique and in particular clustering also to address this kind of problems. Let me say that for this kind of problems, of course, you should also try to use supervised learning techniques like, for example, linear regression or logistic regression. These are all things that I think you have studied during this school, and I'm sure that you must have some idea on how to do that.
I also ask a question.
Sorry, from our literature review, we have actually seen that classification has been used in many works to do the in drug discovery, but fewer works have been done with clustering. So we want to do some things using clustering instead of the supervised learning. That's where we are at the work.
Okay, so the question is
we actually want to apply clustering in the work instead of the supervised learning.
What are the disadvantages of the supervised learning?
I'm sorry, but I am a little bit lost. I don't understand. So the question is?
Well, it's not a question. I think it's more
application.
They want to do something. Just wait a second. The person I was still here on site. And so, I mean, I think the idea is that you have to try.
Yeah.
And as Alessandro was pointing, there's a lot of research.
And not the best clustering algorithm to apply, because they were mentioning
I mean, the algorithm is probably not the main problem. The most difficult thing is going to be to find the best scriptures.
Okay.
You're going to have to try.
All right.
And we can have the question online, if you still have time, Alessandro.
Yes.
Yes, okay. So the question online.
Online. All right. Sorry.
There was someone online who wanted
to. Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. So just my simple question. All this discussion in your classes, how it is the importance considering the type of atoms or molecules? Assume it if it is a hydrogen molecule and other complex molecules and simple atoms like lithium and other heavy metals. So how these all these discussions in your class today important considering simple
atoms? Are very, very important because so this is very, very important because
simple atoms.
You use the deep. So that's what I was trying to convey in my one of my previous answers. You, if you want to describe a data set which includes very different organic molecules, then you must use features which are designed for that. If you want to describe a material which is composed by one element or two elements, then you describe, then you use features which are designed for that. So the thing is that that a really key point is describing your system with an appropriate class of features. So this thing is different according to your system. So the message that so an important take-home message is that there are approaches which allow you to decide if a feature is good or not. So this is something that so there is not only based on your chemical or physical intuition, but there are quantitative approaches which allow you to decide if a description that you have chosen is appropriate or not.
Thank you. Edward has a question in the chat. I don't know if you took it.
Another question in the chat.
Yeah.
Can I use clustering in study dislocation movement in an interstitial alloy? Well, in principle, you can use clustering to study anything that you can imagine. The thing is that clustering by itself is not something that you can use it on its own. It's something that you typically use it to obtain a simplified description of your data landscape. So that's actually the most important thing of clustering, is that this brings you to knowledge and understanding. Doesn't bring you, so it's not that you can use only clustering for everything, but basically clustering is typically a step that you can do to simplify your data set in such a way that you can then perform in principle other things. Like for example, you can first perform clustering and then do supervised learning, but instead of using all your data, you just use representative for each cluster. So this is another typical thing that you can do.
I have a question.
Yes.
Now you ask about researchers, students try to look for patterns in a noisy data. I didn't get it quite clearly. Is there not an approach to be able to probably deconvolve or maybe do a filtration in order to get some information from the noise rather than?
Well,
what are the disadvantages?
This is a very, very difficult question. And I would say that the answer strongly depends on the context. So recognizing noise is something that, for example, in signal processing, you typically do it exploiting the spectral properties of your signal. In other contexts, you can have, so it depends on what you call noise. Noise can be, I don't know, an irrelevant information. Well, this is difficult to spot. Noise is experimental error. Well, this thing you can do it by assuming that your noise is Gaussian distributed. So this the answer. I don't know. Maybe somebody else has a more clear answer to this question. But in my personal impression, how you recognize noise from signal strongly depends on your context. It's a highly non-trivial thing.
Okay, all right, thank you very much.
So maybe I will take one last question because then I have to basically have another meeting. I'm sorry for that. You can, okay, needless to say that you can write a mail to me. So if you have any other question, this is my mail. I will be very, very happy to answer to other questions by mail or in any other manner. No, I can be much more specific. Today, unfortunately, I wasn't actually able to show you most of the things that I had prepared because we, went up in a very nice question and answer session, which is always very good, but I didn't actually show you all that I wanted to show you. Okay?
Thank you very much, Alexandra. I think there's no more questions in the audience.
Very good.
So thank you again for everything.
Thank you very much. And enjoy the school.
Thank you.
Thank you. So thank you very much, Alessandro. Sorry, just today, not to be at all. The reason is there's a speaker, particularly has been difficult to get. So when he proposed sometimes, I didn't want to shift the time. So we'll meet him 1 o'clock. Don't worry, you won't miss anything. So we'll have him soon, 1 to 2. 2 o'clock, we'll go for lunch. 3 o'clock, we'll come back. Before you leave, you have coffee drink. So we still concerned with about food, the amount of food. Only that we are just in time. We'll just hang out there. We like to stand up and walk around and water. At 1 o'clock we will come and then up to 2 o'clock. Then 2 o'clock we don't have it. Look at the schedule. I think from Wednesday, I think we'll give you like a project. It was a woman that wants to be speak.
So what are you up to in terms of machine learning? What are you doing with machine learning?
The one I did supercomputing activities, the one I still have.
The master student that was interested in doing that, but she didn't show up very much this year, so it's a bit of a disaster. I will see if she shows during the summer.
Great.
There's this large database for superconductivity.
Yeah, superconductivity. Yeah. Yeah, we saw that already. But the problem is, okay, my take on it is that, my take on it is that you shouldn't do the machine learning on all the things, because the mechanisms are different. So the description will be.
But I mean, you would hope that a good machine learning model can find the different mechanisms.
Yeah.
If you have enough features.
There's this phoenix type that are magnetic, I mean, I contain ion. They're not supposed to be superconducting, and now they're superconducting. I think those are different from electrons. And then the ceramics are different. So I want to sort, we try to sort, yeah, but still we found. The problem is DFT. Yeah. The material that is insulating, DFT predicts it.
We're also working on my paper that and we apply. We are currently working on a future chip on diagnosis. Okay. So it's something I will, but this one makes use of images instead of that should be neural network. Maybe.
Okay. Images microscopic.
Yes. We gather the images. So the machine learning that we analyze the image and then tell you whether the image has a failure or not. Okay, that's the question that I was
looking for. Yes. She's the second yes, thank you, very much. Yeah.
I want to talk to you about the project.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because lately I was thinking about emerging machine learning too in the context. Yeah.
It is a good idea. Yeah, but I'm afraid you can do that. Okay, you have to promise me that you stay in academia.
What?
You have to promise me that you stay in academia.
I didn't get the question.
That you stay in academia.
I am in academia.
Yeah, but once you learn machine learning, then Google will say come, or Amazon will say come, and you
can go. I understand. I'm not that smart.
No. Once you do machine
learning, maybe. Maybe.
Hello, everybody. Do you see my screen?
Oh, sorry. Hold on.
You can see your screen.
Awesome. So,
yes, we can see your screen.
I'm ready.
Okay. We are recording, right?